Good morning, students. Welcome to your first class of accountancy of second year PUC. And we will be beginning with chapter number 2, that is accounting for partnership basic concept. Now, if you just have a glance into the syllabus of second PU accountancy, we have altogether 11 chapters included, which is divided into two parts. Part 1 has total of 5 chapters and remaining 6 chapters are included in part 2 of your syllabus. Okay. So now the reason why we have started with the chapter number 2 is partnership is a concept which you are already familiar with. You have studied it in detail in your first year business studies. Most of the theory concept of partnership is already covered in your business studies of first PUC. So now, first of all, let us see the meaning of partnership. So as I told you, it is a general topic. So meaning of partnership is nothing but it is a type of business which is run by two or more people, or we can say that it is an association of two or more people where they run a lawful business and they share profit and losses among themselves. Okay. Now, while talking particularly in India, there is an act which governs partnership here, and that is Indian Partnership Act. Passed in the year 1932. So now this act frames all the rules and regulation which every partnership businesses will have to follow in India. Or we can say that all the partnership businesses in India will have to follow rules and regulation framed by this act. Okay. Now this act has given a very famous and important definition of partnership, which goes like this. Section 4 of the Indian Partnership Act defines partnership as the relation between persons who have agreed to share the profits of the business carried on by all or any of them acting for all. Okay. So as I said you, this is a very famous definition given as per section 4 of the Indian Partnership Act passed in the year 1932. Okay. Now once again let me read this definition for you. The definition goes like this: the relation between persons who have agreed to share the profits of the business carried on by all or any of them acting for all.
Now let me read this definition for you in 3 parts, so that you will be able to understand it very easily. So the definition starts like this: relation between persons. Now what kind of relation are we talking about? Now the Indian Partnership Act clearly states that in its section 5 that any person cannot be a partner by his status. That is, unlike in the case of joint little family business, where a person becomes a member of joint little family business just because he is born in that particular family, this doesn't happen in the case of partnership. Now, to become a partner, you should compulsorily enter into an agreement. And that agreement is called as a relation. It can be also called as some kind of understanding. So thus, Indian Partnership Act clearly says that some kind of agreement is compulsory. Now, that agreement can be either verbal or written. Indian Partnership Act does not make any compulsion regarding having oral agreement or written agreement. It is left to the freedom of partners to choose whether they want to have oral agreement or do they want to continue with written agreement. So whatever it is, oral or written, some kind of relation or some kind of understanding or agreement must be compulsory. Okay. So the relation between persons. Now if you see here, the word persons is included, which ourselves, which means that minimum two people are required to start a partnership business. Okay. Now, you may be asking, if minimum two members are required, what may be the maximum number? Now, as per Companies Act of 2013, the maximum number of partners was 100. Later, in the year 2014, it was revised back to 50. So thus, minimum two people are required to start a partnership business. And as per Companies Act of 2013, it was 100. Later, in the year 2014, it was reduced back to 50. So this was the first section of the definition, which says that some kind of relation between persons are required.
Now the second part of the definition says that who have agreed to share the profits of the business. Now this part of the definition tells that as per Indian Partnership Act, to be called as partnership, there should be some kind of business involved. Now you already know what do you mean by business. Business means some kind of trading in goods or provision of services, whatever it is. Now for example, if you and your friend decide to share a mobile phone among yourself, then that cannot be called as partnership, because you don't have any element of business involved. Now one more thing what you'll have to keep in point here is, now that business must be lawful. Indian Partnership Act clearly says that only that business can be called as partnership which are performed within the limits of law. That is, for example, if two people rob a bank and decide to share that money among themselves, then that cannot be called as partnership because that does not come within the limits of law. So whatever business is being performed by the partners should be lawful. Okay. So here we come to know that there should be some kind of business involved and that should be lawful. Then the partners must agree to share the profits of the business. Now in the case of partnership, the owners are the partners, and as each one of them usually contribute capital, everyone is entitled to receive profit. So whatever profit will be earned by them will be shared among themselves. In what ratio, it depends on their partnership deed or agreement. Okay. Now some of you might have confusion, what if loss? In case of loss, don't they have to share it? Now, even though it is not mentioned in the definition, as profits are being shared among partners, even in the case of losses also, it has to be shared. Now, the reason why it is not mentioned in the definition is that it is implied. Implied means even if it is not told, it is applicable. That is, even if you get profit, you share among partners. Even if you get loss, it has to be shared. Okay. So this was the second section of the definition, which says that some kind of business must be there, a lawful business must be there, and whether profit or loss, it has to be shared among people. Okay. Now coming to the last section of the definition, it says that business must be carried on by all or any of them acting for all. Now this part of the definition is termed as mutual agency. Now this part of the definition talks about management or decision making. Now while it comes to management or decision making, Indian Partnership Act has given two options. That is, either the management or decision making can be carried on by all or done by all. Or the second option is that any one person can do the management, can do the decisions on behalf of the other partners. Okay. Now let me explain this with the help of an example. Assume there are three partners involved in a business, A, B and C. Now Indian Partnership Act clearly says that every partner acts as both principal as well as agent. Now for example, if A takes any kind of decision on behalf of B and C, then A is called as an agent, B and C is called as the principal. Now the reason why A is called as an agent, because he is doing the work, he is taking decision on behalf of B and C. Now the reason why B and C are called as a principal, because someone else is working on their behalf. Okay, so the last part of the definition talks about management or decision making. So where there are two options where it can be either done by all the partners collectively, or else any one partner can take decision on behalf of the others. Okay. So this was about the definition. Once the definition is over, next let us see the meaning of three terms. That is, first term is partner, meaning of partner, meaning of partnership firm, meaning of partnership firm name. Okay. Now people, those who join partnership firm, they are called as partners. Okay. Or people, those who join partnership firm individually we call them as partners. People or persons who join the partnership firm, we call them as partnership firm collectively. That is, individually we call them as partners, collectively we call them as partnership firm. And the name under which the business is run, for example, XYZ firm. Okay. Now the name under which that partnership firm is run, that is called as partnership firm name. Now going on to the next topic, that is features of partnership business. You have already studied this in detail in your first year business studies. So we will be looking into this topic in brief. So altogether I have pointed out 5 features of partnership business. And the first one is, there should be 2 or more persons. Second one is agreement. Third one is, there should be some kind of business. Then mutual agency. Last one is sharing of profits. Okay. Now briefly let us look into these features one by one. The first feature of partnership tells that there should be minimum 2 or more persons. I have told you this while explaining the definition itself. Indian Partnership Act clearly says a relation between persons would indicate that a minimum 2 people are required to start a partnership business. And when it comes to maximum limit, as per Companies Act of 2013, the maximum limit was 100. Later, in the year 2014, it was reduced back to 50. Okay. So the first feature tells minimum 2 or more persons. Now, feature number 2, which talks about agreement, which tells that Indian Partnership Act clearly states that some kind of agreement is compulsory. I have also stated that there are 2 types of agreement usually, oral agreement, written agreement. And Partnership Act does not make any compulsion or does not force you to go for oral agreement, or neither forces you to go for written agreement. It is left to the freedom of partners to decide whether they want to have oral agreement. Oral agreement means verbal agreement. Or they want to have everything written systematically, and do they want to go for written agreement. Okay. Now usually, even though there is no compulsion, now usually people go for a written agreement because it is safe. Now the reason why it is safe, because it acts as an evidence for future purpose. And even in the case of filing a suit means case. If you want to file a case on someone, then if you want to take that case to the court of law, then compulsorily you will have to maintain this partnership deed. Okay, if there is no partnership deed, you cannot file a case against anyone. Okay. So whatever it is, whether oral or written, some kind of agreement is compulsory. Now this is stated in feature number 2. Now coming to the feature number 3, business, which states that Indian Partnership Act clearly tells that there should be some kind of business involved. Either production or trading or giving any kind of services, whatever it is, some kind of business is compulsory, and that business should come within the limits of law. That is, if you do any kind of unlawful activity in the name of business, then that cannot be called as partnership. So there should be an element of business which comes within the limit of law. Coming to the 4th one, mutual agency. Now this mutual agency is nothing but the last section of the definition, which clearly says that business can be carried on by all or any of them acting for all. Now this part of the definition talks about management, which I have already discussed in the definition. That is, when it comes to management, there are two options. Either it can be done by all, carried on by all, or any one can do the management on behalf of others. Okay, and Indian Partnership Act also says that every partner will act both as a principal as well as the agent. Now coming to the last feature, sharing of profit. Okay, now whatever profit or losses our partnership business will incur, it has to be shared among all the partners. Okay, now in what ratio it has to be shared, it will be mentioned in the partnership deed. So these are the five features of partnership. Dear students, now going to the next topic in chapter 2, that is partnership deed. Now this topic also you have studied in brief in your first year business studies. Okay, so now while talking about the definition, while explaining the definition, I just told that there should be some kind of agreement involved, and there are mainly two types of agreement that usually is followed in partnership. The one is oral agreement and the other is written agreement. And I also stated that Indian Partnership Act does not make any compulsion or does not force you to follow any of these agreement. That is, it is left to you or it is left to the partners whether they want to go with the oral agreement or do they want to follow the written agreement. Okay. Now, if the partnership firm decides to go with the written agreement, then that written agreement is called as partnership deed. Or to say in a simple words, the written agreement of partnership, not the oral agreement, once again, the written agreement of partnership is called as partnership deed. Now this partnership deed is also called by one more name, that is articles of partnership. Articles of partnership is also the other name what we use in the place of partnership deed. Okay, so now let us go into the detailed meaning of partnership deed, which goes like this. When the agreement is written, signed by all the partners, and duly stamped as per the Stamp Act, then it is called as partnership deed. So this is a bit a detailed meaning of partnership, which says that when the agreement is in writing, that is all the rules and regulations that you will be following while running your partnership business, every partner's name, address, details, or their rights, duties, capital, all the details, when you have it in writing. And it is usually written in a stamp paper. You might be knowing what stamp paper is. So when the agreement is written, it should be written, all the details must be in writing, and it should be signed by all the partners. All the partners who are included in that partnership business must sign it, and it should be duly stamped. Stamped means government seal is required. Okay, and the stamping is usually done as per the Stamp Act. Now this Stamp Act was passed in the year 1899. And once a document is stamped, it means that it is legal. And if you want to take that document to the court of law, then this stamping is required. Okay. So, meaning of partnership deed, agreement should be in writing and it should be signed by all the partners. When all the partners sign, it means that all have given their consent. Okay. So now, when it is signed by all the partners, and it is stamped, sealed as per the Stamp Act passed in the year 1899, it is called as partnership deed. So let me conclude that in brief words, partnership deed is nothing but it is just a written agreement of partnership. Okay, and it contains all the details through which you will be running your partnership business. Okay, now one thing what I want to tell you is that now once you frame a partnership deed, it is not that it cannot be changed later. Now if you want to change the contents in your partnership deed, you will have to take consent or permission of all the partners. If all the partners give you the permission, then you are allowed to change the contents in the partnership deed. So you know the meaning of partnership deed. Let me recall it. partnership deed is nothing but the written agreement of partnership. Or when the partners decide that, they will go on with having a written agreement where they will be writing all the rules and regulation and then they will be doing their business. Then that kind of agreement is called as partnership deed, which is also called as articles of partnership. Okay. Now going to the next topic, which is very important for the 2 marks, that is contents of partnership deed. Usually you will be asked to write any 2 or any 4 contents of partnership deed. Now I have written around 8 contents. Let us see what are the usual contents that are usually entered in the case of partnership deed. Okay. So the first content included in the partnership deed is name and address of the firm. So what is the name under which you will be running your partnership business and exact address where it will be located, where the business will be done. Okay. Now that is the first content that should be included in the partnership deed, name and address of the partnership firm. Similarly, content number 2, name and address of all the partners. Who are the partners who are included in your business? Their name, their specific details, their address, their phone number, all their details must be included in the partnership deed. Now going to content number 3, date of commencement of business. Date of commencement means date of starting. That particular date on which you have started your business, that must be mentioned in the partnership deed. Date of commencement of the partnership business. Going for the 4th one, rights, duties and responsibility of each partner. Every partner in the business will be given a particular right, responsibility, or he or she will be liable for something. Okay. Now every partner's rights, duties and liabilities will be usually mentioned in the partnership deed. Now going for the 5th one, very important, sharing ratio of profit and loss. Now while studying the definition of partnership, we saw that whatever profit or loss will be incurred in the partnership business will be shared among partners. Now in which ratio you will be sharing that profit or loss will be usually mentioned in the partnership deed. For example, there are 3 partners A, B and C, and it is entered in the partnership deed that profit sharing ratio is 3:2:1. So out of the total profit, A will be getting 3/6 share, B will be getting 2/6 share and C will be given 1/6 share. So that particular ratio in which profit or loss will be shared among the partners will be mentioned in the partnership deed. Okay. Or sometimes it may also be mentioned in the partnership deed that whatever profit or losses are there, it has to be shared equally. In that case, the profit sharing ratio will be 1:1:1. Whatever profit will be earned or loss will be incurred, that has to be shared among all the partners equally. So whatever it is, the ratio that is specified in the partnership deed will be followed by the partners. So 5th content of the partnership deed says about sharing ratio of profit and loss. Now going for the 6th one, interest on capital, interest on drawing or interest on loan. Okay. Now these are the terms which we will be solving or which will be included in solving problems later on. Okay. Now you all know what capital is. It is a basic term that is used in accountancy. Capital is nothing but money invested by the owner in his business. Now our separate legal entity says that business and the owner are separate. Even if he is the owner of the business, he will be treated as an outsider, and whatever capital he will be putting in the business, on that business is supposed to give him interest. Okay. So at what rate of interest on capital will be given will be mentioned in the partnership deed. Now come to the 2nd one, interest on drawing. Now similarly to capital, you also know that what do you mean by drawing. Now according to separate entity concept again, as the owner is treated as an outsider, if he takes any money from the business for his personal use, for example for his son's education or daughter's marriage or paying his life insurance premium fees or any kind of goods in cash or kind, then we term it as drawings. Okay. Now even if it is owner's money or partner's money only, so for what money he has taken from the business, he will have to give interest to the business, and at what percent interest will be charged on the drawings will be mentioned in the partnership deed. Okay. Now going for the last one, interest on loan. sometimes business may be in need of urgent cash and capital contributed by the partners will not be sufficient. In that case, if any partner gives any excess loan, in that case, what is the interest to be charged, or what is the interest to be given to the loan or advances given by these partners will be mentioned in the partnership deed. Okay. Now, in the case of interest on capital, we will have to keep one thing in mind. Interest on capital will be given only if the business earns profit. No matter how much capital the owner has put, the partner has put, if the business is running under losses, then interest on capital need not be given. Okay? So this particular interest rate on interest on capital, interest on drawing, interest on loan will be specified in the partnership deed. Now, going to the seventh one, salaries, commission payable to partner. Okay. Now, we all know that every partner is entitled to a certain percentage of profit. Now, other than profit, if he does any kind of extra work or overtime work or anything extra, will he be entitled to any kind of extra salary? Should he be given any kind of extra commission? We term it as remuneration. Remuneration is nothing but salary or commission. Okay, so just if any partner does any kind of extra work, should he be given any extra salary? Should he be given any kind of commission? Will be entered in the partnership deed. Okay, now going for the eighth one, rules to be followed at the time of admission, retirement, and death of a partner. Now, in the case of partnership firm, admission, retirement, death may happen. Now, admission of a partner means, in case you are in need of an extra partner, you take a new partner into a partnership firm, that is called as admission. Or if a partner wants to leave the business, he wants to go out of your business, then that is termed as retirement. If a partner dies, we call it as death of a partner. Now, in these three instances, what rules our business may have to follow will be entered in the partnership deed. So these are the few eight partnership deed contents. Once again, name and address of the firm, name and address of partners, date of commencement of business, date of starting of business, rights, duties and liabilities of each partner, then the ratio in which profit or loss will be shared, interest on capital, particular rate of interest on capital or interest on drawing or interest on loan, if any partner is supposed to be paid any extra salary commission in the name of remuneration, then rules to be followed at the time of admission, retirement or death of a partner. Now, other than these also, we also have a few more contents like capital contributed by each partner. How much capital each partner has contributed in his name, that also will be entered in the partnership deed. Other than this, in case of dispute, you know the meaning of dispute. Dispute means misunderstanding. Any kind of misunderstanding arises in the partnership firm, how to solve it, the way to settlement of dispute, if any dispute occur, will that be taken to the court or will that be settled among themselves, will that also will be mentioned in the partnership deed. Then how to maintain bank accounts, as there are more than one person included here in partnership business. Who will be handling the bank accounts? Will it be done by one person on behalf of others? Or will the bank account will be operated by all the partners? All these information will be included in the partnership deed. Okay? So you just remember the meaning of partnership deed. And it is that particular act under which it is prepared, that is Stamp Act. And these are the few contents of partnership deed. Students, till now in our second chapter, we have seen the topics, that is, what is a partnership business, definition of partnership, then we saw in brief the features of partnership, then we went to a topic called as partnership deed and its contents. Now going to a very important topic, which is also there for your practical oriented, provisions relating to accounting or rules in absence of partnership deed. Now we all know, what do you mean by partnership? That is, written agreement of partnership is called as partnership deed. I also told you that maintaining of partnership deed is not compulsory. You can even go for oral agreement. Now see, when you're following partnership deed, there is no confusion because you'll be running your business as it is written in the partnership deed, and it will always also act as an evidence. But when you're following any kind of oral agreement, there is a lot of confusion may be created. So as a solution to it, our Indian Partnership Act of 1932 has framed 5 ready-made rules which are to be followed in absence of partnership deed or when the business is following oral agreement. So when you're not following written agreement and when you're going for oral agreement, when you have opted for oral agreement, these 5 rules will have to be compulsorily followed. Now first rule is related to profit sharing ratio. Second rule is related to interest on capital. Third rule is related to interest on drawing. Fourth rule is related to interest on advance is nothing but loan. Last rule is related to remuneration for firm's work. Okay, so now let us see what rules our Indian Partnership Act has framed which are to be followed in case of oral agreement or when a written agreement is not there. Okay, so first rule says is regarding how to share profit or loss sharing ratio. See, if we are following partnership deed, there we will be specifying a particular ratio in which we will be sharing our profit and loss, and accordingly it will be done. But here there is nothing written. So in that case, whatever Indian Partnership Act says is that when there is no partnership deed, profit or loss has to be shared equally. That is, no matter how much capital each partner might have put, no matter how much difference there is in the capital contributed by each partner, if you're following oral agreement, then whether profit or loss has to be shared equally among all the partners. If there are 2 partners, then the ratio will be 1:1. If there are 3 partners, ratio will be 1:1:1 accordingly. Okay. Now, going for the second rule relating to interest on capital. I told you while discussing regarding the contents of partnership deed, as a partner is treated as an outsider according to separate legal entity concept, how much capital he has introduced, on that he is entitled to get a certain percentage of interest. Okay. Now, in the case of partnership deed, that percentage will be mentioned. Accordingly, it will be done. And once again, I want to mention that interest on capital will be given only if the business is earning any kind of profit. No need to give interest on capital if there is loss. Okay. But when you are following oral agreement, Indian Partnership Act clearly says that there is no interest on capital. No interest on capital is given. No matter how much capital the partners might have introduced, they won't be having the right to ask any percentage of interest on capital, only when you're following oral agreement. Now coming to the third one, third rule is relating to interest on drawing. Drawing means any amount taken by the owner, a partner, for his personal use, and whatever drawings he has done, on that he is supposed to usually give interest. Okay. Now in the case of partnership deed, usually a percentage will be mentioned, and on that percentage interest will be given by the partners. But if we are following oral agreement, Indian Partnership Act clearly says that no interest on drawing is charged. That is, no matter how much money partner has taken for his personal use, no matter how much goods or how much asset if he has taken for his personal use, no interest will be charged by the business on it. Okay. Now going for the fourth one, interest on advance or loan. Other than the capital, if any of the partner has introduced any kind of extra money in the form of advance or loan, in the form of advance or loan, if any of the partner has given any kind of extra money, then listen carefully, interest at the rate of 6% per annum is to be given. Usually students confuse here. Say interest on capital? No. Interest on drawing? No. But interest on loan is 6% and this per annum is necessary or else you will be losing your mark. Okay? So other than the capital, if any of the partner has introduced any of your extra amount in the form of loan, then he is entitled to get 6% interest on it from the partnership business. Okay. Now going for the last condition, last provision or last rule, which talks about remuneration for firm's work. I just told you while talking about the contents of partnership deed, so remuneration is nothing but salary or extra commission. If any of the partner has done any kind of extra work, overtime work, for the sake of partnership business, then if you're following oral agreement, then no extra salary or remuneration will be given. That is, no matter how much hard work he might have put as an extra work, he doesn't have any right to ask any kind of extra salary or extra remuneration. Now, these rules are applicable, once again, keep in mind, only when you're following oral agreement or in the case you're not following partnership deed. Okay. So now this question is very important for your practical oriented. They will give you the contents. You will have to state the rules. Okay. Now, first content, once again, is relating to profit sharing ratio. Now, in the absence of partnership deed, profit or loss has to be shared equally. Second content, relating to interest on capital. In the absence of partnership deed, no interest on capital is given. No matter how much extra capital he has put, he won't be getting any interest on it. Interest on drawing, no extra interest on drawing is charged. No matter how much money he has taken for his personal use, he won't be charged any percentage of interest. Okay. Fourth one, interest on loan or advance. If any partner has given any extra money in the form of loan, he will be charged interest at the rate of 6% per annum. Last one is relating to remuneration of firm's work, that any partner is not entitled to get any extra salary or remuneration. Anyhow, he will be getting equal share in the profit or loss. So coming back to chapter number 2. Accounting for partnership, basic concept. So till now we have dealt with the basic theory included in the partnership concept. Now going to the first basic concept that is included in partnership, that is calculation of interest on drawing. Okay. Now you all know the meaning of drawing. Drawing is nothing but any amount taken by the owner or partner from the business for his personal use. Okay. Now in the case of calculation of interest on drawing, there are usually three methods followed. The first method is product method. Second one is average period method, also called as shortcut method. And the third one is direct method. And for your exam point of view, the first two methods are very important. Okay, for 6 marks, you will usually be asked either to calculate interest on drawing under product method or to calculate interest on drawing under average period method. Okay. So now, let us see how to identify which method to be followed in calculating interest on drawing. Now, one thing I want to specify before going into detail regarding various methods of calculation of interest on drawing. No matter which method you will be following, you will be getting the same answer. But here, under second PUC, NCERT wants you to identify which method to be followed. So, as per the NCERT, it clearly defines that if the drawings are regular, we will be going for a method, and if the drawing is irregular, we will be going for the another method. Now, what do you mean by drawing to be regular, drawing being irregular? That is, regular drawing means whenever you withdraw same amount in regular interval of time, we call it as regular drawing. I have written here an example. Mr. A withdraws ₹1,000 beginning of each month. See here, beginning of every month. Here the time gap is same. Every month beginning, he is withdrawing the same amount, that is 1,000. Now we call such drawings as regular drawing. When you know in advance when you will be doing the drawing, such kind of drawing is called as regular drawing. And in that case, we will be following the method, that is second one, usually average period method. Or else you can even go for the last method, that is direct method. Okay, now as per NCERT, it states that when the drawing is regular, when you draw equal amount for an equal interval of time, regular interval of time, then we go for the second and third method, that is average period method or direct method. Okay, and at the same time, if the drawings are irregular, that is you are not withdrawing same amount and there is no regular period intervals, in that case we go for the first method, that is product method. Now we give more importance to product method when compared to any other method of calculating of interest on drawing. Now I have written one more example here relating to irregular drawing. Mr. A withdraws ₹1,000 on 30th June 2019. This is the first drawing. Next, he withdraws ₹5,000 on 1st September 2019, second drawing. And lastly, he withdrew ₹6,000 on 31st December 2019. Now, if you observe this question, we will come to know that neither the amount is regular, 1,000 first, 5,000 next, 6,000 last. Neither the dates are similar. First is June last, then came September first, last came December last. Okay, so when the amount is not regular, neither the time interval is regular, we usually go for product method. Okay, so to sum up, there are mainly three types of method usually followed while calculating of interest on drawing, that is product method, average period method and direct method.